Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
We have a special day today. We have, of course, we have the celebration of the Holy Eucharist, and we have Veterans Honors today. And it's great to see so many of you here. I'll give some instructions as we get to that part of the service about what we're going to do. I'll tell you, you can brace yourself for later because we have a bagpiper to play two pieces for us, especially for the veterans ceremony. So again, welcome on this special day.
Thank you.
make us children of God and heirs of eternal life. Grant that, having this hope, we may purify ourselves as he is pure, that when he comes again with power and great glory, we may be made like him in his eternal and glorious kingdom, where he lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen. Amen.
Please be seated for the lessons.
A reading from Joshua. Then Joshua gathered all the tribes of Israel to Shechem, and summoned the elders, the heads, the judges, and the officers of Israel. And they presented themselves before God. And Joshua said to all the people, "Thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, long ago your ancestors, Terah and his sons, Abraham and Nahor, lived beyond the Euphrates and served other gods. Now therefore revere the Lord, and serve him in sincerity and in faithfulness. Put away the gods that your ancestors served beyond the river and in Egypt, and serve the Lord. Now if you're unwilling to serve the Lord, choose this day whom you will serve, whether the gods your ancestors served in the region beyond the river, or the gods of the Amorites, in whose land you are living. But as for me and my household, we will serve the Lord." Then the people answered, "Far be it from us that we should forsake the Lord to serve other gods. For it is the Lord our God who brought us and our ancestors up from the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery, and who did those great signs in our sight. He protected us along all the way that we went, and among all the peoples through whom we passed. And the Lord drove out before us all the peoples, Amorites who live in the land. Therefore we will also serve the Lord, for he is our God." But Joshua said to the people, "You cannot serve the Lord, for he is a holy God. He is a jealous God. He will not forgive your transgressions or your sins. If you forsake the Lord and serve foreign gods, then he will turn and do you harm and consume you after having done you good." And the people said to Joshua, "No, we will serve the Lord." Then Joshua said to the people, "You are witnesses against yourselves that you have chosen the Lord to serve him." And they said, "We are witnesses." He said, "Then put away the foreign gods that are among you and incline your hearts to the Lord, the God of Israel." The people said to Joshua, "The Lord our God we will serve. In him we will obey." So Joshua made a covenant with the people that day. He made statutes and ordinances for them at Shechem. Hear what the Holy Spirit is saying to God's people.
Thanks be to God. Let us pray a portion of Psalm 78 responsively, dividing at the half verse. "Hear my teaching, O my people.
Incline your ears to the words of my mouth.
I will open my mouth in a parable.
I will declare the mysteries of ancient times.
That which we have heard and known, and what our forefathers have told us.
We will not hide from their children.
We will recount to generations to come the praiseworthy deeds and the power of the Lord.
And the wonderful works he has done.
He gave his decrees to Jacob and established a law for Israel,
which he commanded them to teach their children,
that the generations to come might know, and the children yet unborn,
that they in their turn might tell it to their children,
so that they might put their trust in God,
and not forget the deeds of God, but keep his commandments."
A reading from Paul, first letter to the Thessalonians. We do not want you to be uninformed, brothers and sisters, about those who have died, so that you may not grieve as others do who have no hope. For since we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so, through Jesus, God will bring with him those who have died. For this we declare to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive, who are left until the coming of the Lord, will by no means precede those who have died. For the Lord himself, with a cry of command, with the archangel's call, and with the sound of God's trumpet will descend from heaven, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive, who are left, will be caught up in the clouds together with them to meet the Lord in the air. And so we will be with the Lord forever. Therefore, encourage one another with these words. Hear what the Holy Spirit is saying to God's people.
Thanks be to God.
Give us some of your oil, for our lamps are going out. But the wise replied, no, there will not be enough for you and for us. You had better go to the dealers and buy some for yourselves. And while they went to buy it, the bridegroom came, and those who were ready went with him into the wedding banquet, and the door was shut. Later, the other bridesmaids came also, saying, Lord, Lord, open to us. But he replied, truly I tell you, I do not know you. Keep awake, therefore, for you know neither the day nor the hour. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. During his 1960 presidential campaign, John Kennedy often closed his speeches with a story of Colonel Davenport, the Speaker of the Connecticut House of Representatives. And this is that story. One day in 1789, the sky over Hartford darkened ominously, and some of the representatives glancing out the windows feared that the end was at hand. Calming the members of the House who were calling for immediate adjournment, Davenport stood up and said, "The day of judgment is either approaching or it is not. If it is not, there is no cause for adjournment. If it is, I choose to be found here, doing my duty. Therefore, I wish that candles be brought." End quote. The theme for all of the lessons for this day in the church year is about being ready and being prepared and about being about our duties. Children seem to be all about readiness, don't they? And anticipation. 2 days before the family's annual vacation, the kids are already packed, ready to go, urging their parents on. They are sleepless nights the night before, so filled with anticipation. The adults, on the other hand, are adults. Vacations come and go every year. We could just take off in the car and plan our next stop and find a motel along the way. And we'll have plenty of time to finish packing in the morning. There will always be tomorrow, right? Wrong. I visited a woman who, having dropped her husband off at the airport, just like so many other mornings, made the routine trip home, only to be involved on her trip in a really bad crash on the expressway. Fortunately, she was not seriously hurt, but her car was now history. She said, "It's always a bit frightening to realize how fragile life is," she said. "One moment you're moving along just fine, and bang, out of nowhere, everything comes to a halt." She continued, This year, a good friend of mine died at age 60. He just dropped dead of a heart attack. He died unexpectedly. He had a heart condition, he smoked occasionally, and was more than a few pounds overweight. When will we learn to stop using that curious expression, "died unexpectedly"? We are creatures. Our lives are not destined to go on forever. But something about us wants to conceive of our lives as a river that goes on and on. I've been that way for a long time. But no, our lives have a beginning and an end. That means that opportunities come our way and do not come again. There are moments that occur and that do not reoccur. God intrudes, breaks in, but often only in a momentary, fleeting way, so that we need to be ready. Isn't that the message we take from Jesus' parable today? In the weddings of his day, the focus was not on the bride, but it was on the bridegroom. It was the groom who footed the bill for the wedding. It was the groom's occasion to show off for family and friends. And the entire wedding was done on his terms. Following a wedding, 10 bridesmaids departed with their lamps or torches filled with oil and left for the bride's home, where the groom would meet and escort his bride to his parents' house. While awaiting the groom's arrival, 5 of the maids realized they did not take enough oil for their lamps, and when the groom arrived at midnight, they were out of oil. When making a request of the 5 maids who had brought enough oil to share their extra, the foolish maids were rebuffed and were told to go out and buy their own. While off buying their oil, the groom arrived, and the 5 maids who had prepared ahead and had enough oil went into the banquet, and the door was shut. When the 5 other bridesmaids, the other maids arrived, they found themselves banned from the banquet, because they were unprepared for the bridegroom's arrival. Today we're near the end of Matthew's gospel, toward the end of the church year, and here is a story about endings. Time is up. The ones who were locked out perhaps intended to prepare well, had good intentions to get oil for their lamps. We all know where that road can lead. But somehow we reassure ourselves with, there will always be a tomorrow. The sun comes up every morning. Don't rush to judgment. But life cannot be endlessly deferred. There are opportunities that come to us that don't come again. Jesus urges us to be alert, to watch, to be prepared. For the time in which we live at this moment may be the time for decision and commitment. So what are we doing while we're waiting. I wonder if the following story could be a parable for our relationship to God. We say that we want God close to us, that we would like God in our lives, but are we ready when God comes? The novelist Reynolds Price, in his book, A Whole New Life, tells of a stunning vision of meeting Jesus, Jesus baptizing in the Jordan, a vision that Price was given one night during the depth of his illness with cancer. He reports the vision in the book with calm certitude, and many people, having read his book, wrote to Reynolds Price telling him of similar experiences when they vividly knew the real presence of Christ. He received thousands of those letters. Price said that when he was being interviewed about the book, the most frequent asked questions were about the vision. Did it really happen? Did it happen just the way he described it? Was he sure that it was really a vision of Christ, or just something in his imagination? When one interviewer on a New York television program pressed him at length on this, Price finally said, "Look, I'm from North Carolina. Maybe that explains it. When you grow up in that part of the world, you just naturally get the impression that Jesus cares about you and that one day Jesus will get to you." So when the vision happened, I just thought to myself, well, here it is. I was ready for it, being from North Carolina. Jesus ends today's parable with the admonition to watch, to be ready for the time that is the right time, time fulfilled, our moment when God arrives on tiptoes or comes rushing, or surprises us with light or speaks. Watch. Be ready. You may ask, what should we be doing in the meantime, in this in-between time, in this time of waiting? One answer comes through the words of the prophet Amos, speaking for the Lord to God's people, words not easy on the ears of those people. "I'm not interested in your burnt offerings or grain offerings, your solemn assemblies and festivals, but let justice roll down like waters and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream," end quote. Do justice and righteousness. How do we do those well now? And how might we do those in the future? I'm thinking of this wonderful church family. We can continue to provide loving care for those in need here, the sick, the lonely, the housebound, and others, by bringing meals and prayers, sacraments and flowers, and ourselves. With trips to the doctor and the store and to church, and visits to the home, we can continue our good work and outreach with hope for the homeless and the hungry and the hopeless through a warm and loving meal carefully served right here in our parish hall, which becomes home for a few hours for those folks. And then through reaching out to another parish or ministry in our diocese where resources and hope are falling short, giving from the generosity that we have experienced here through the big heart of Trinity's family. Doing justice and righteousness. How can we ever be fully prepared in this time of waiting? The good news is that we don't have to do these things by ourselves, all on our own. The good news is that God can and will do for us what we cannot do or accomplish by ourselves. No one is ever completely wide awake, and no one is ever running on full all the time when it comes to the spiritual life. We are saved by grace, not by how much oil is in our lamp. Whether we are clever or ill-prepared, whether Christ comes tomorrow or at the end of the turn of the next century, we are saved by God's unconditional, unending love. Being prepared happens when day by day, week by week, we hear God's word and partake this holy meal, opening ourselves to the presence of God. We are made ready each time we are open to the call of God. Following Jesus in our daily lives keeps us alert and awake. Being ready is a wise thing to do, something that comes only with a lifetime of practice. Thank God we don't have to practice alone. The bridegroom is not only coming, but is also the one who waits with us. Come, Lord Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
We now stand and affirm our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God,
the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God.
Prayers of the People can be found on page 5 in the service booklet. Father, we pray for your holy Catholic Church.
That we are all in one.
Grant that every member of the Church may truly and humbly serve you.
That your name may be glorified by all people.
We pray for Michael, our presiding bishop, Jennifer, our bishop, Father Bob, our priest, for our companion diocese, Bor in the Sudan and their Bishop Reuben, Brasilia and their Bishop Mauricio, for the people of Haiti and their Bishop Sachet. In our Anglican cycle of prayer, we pray for Igreja and Glicana de Mocambique, in Angola. We pray for St. James, Vincennes, Mrs. Mary Theobald, Senior Warden, the Reverend Mary Becker, Deacon, all our diocesan partners, all the baptized, and all bishops, priests, and deacons. We pray for Joe, our president, Eric, our governor, Thomas, our mayor, and all who govern and hold authority in the nations of the world. Give us grace to do your will in all that we undertake. Have compassion on those who are hospitalized, for those in convalescent centers or at home, Bill Ashley, Susan Bukov, Bonnie Conover, Sonia Hurley, Candy McPherson, Catherine Holzleiter, Mike Cannon, Lori Crawford, Ross Buckman, and Heather Carter. For the men and women in the armed forces, Ethan Loesch, Audrey McMillan Cole, Reed Ratzlaff, Travis Reed, Zach Webb, and Allison Woodruff. For those who are homeless, unemployed, or underemployed, and all those who suffer from any grief or trouble.
And they may be delivered from their distress.
Give to the departed eternal rest.
Let thy perpetual shine upon them.
We give thanks for the altar flowers today, given in thanksgiving and loving memory of deceased Altar Guild members. Dorothy Campbell, Susan Carney, Florence Kaler, Gloria Ferguson, Helen Fraser, Mary Gregory, Mary Morgan, Terry Morgan, Marilyn Olden, Helen Parsons, Donna Patrohay, Becky Province, Judy Reynolds, Alta Rickard, Ellen Scott, and Bernice Woods. We praise you for all your saints who have entered into joy.
May we also strive to share in your heavenly kingdom.
We pray for those on our daily prayer list, Steve, Catherine, Adriana, and Kyle Holzleiter, and Sonia Hurley. We pray for those who celebrate birthdays or anniversaries this week, including Ross Buckman and Jan Foster. Let us pray for our own needs and those of others, including those on our prayer list, either silently or aloud.
Close your blinds.
My sister-in-law, Jeannie.
Hasten, O Father, the coming of your kingdom, and grant that we, your servants who now live by faith, may with joy behold your Son at his coming in glorious majesty, even Jesus Christ, our only mediator and advocate. Amen. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God,
we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done or by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and humbly repentant. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may align in your will and walk in your ways.
Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
Amen. Please be seated. We now come to a special place in our worship today for our Veterans Day recognition and honors. I want to make sure that I mention that we're honoring all of our vets, those who are here with us today, those who are elsewhere, and those who have died in the past, and also give thanks and pray for their families this day on this Veterans Day weekend. We have a piper today, Denise James. And we have a soloist, Catherine, who's going to be part of our service, and we thank them both for their special gifts. I'd like to introduce Denise James at this time to begin our Veterans Honors.
Thank you.
thankful, as well as many of you, I'm sure, touched. I'm sure to be grateful for those who have raised our awareness of the debt we owe to all those who have served and are serving in the military and in order to preserve our freedoms as Americans. Tom Brokaw did a lot of work and writing and travels in the past and did a wonderful job talking about the greatest generation. And today, Gary Sinise, you may be aware of this fellow, he's an actor, and he has done tremendous support and assistance for all veterans in these days. A few years ago, I was on my way to Washington, D.C. for the first time in my life to take a course at the College of Preachers in Washington, next door to the Washington Cathedral. And while I was in the airplane, I'm thinking, oh my goodness, I'm going to Washington for the first time. And so while we were there, we got to visit Arlington Cemetery, the Tomb of the Unknown, and the Vietnam War Memorial, which were particularly pertinent for me since I had lost friends during that conflict. So today we will honor the vets that are with us. I'm very grateful for those of you that are here, and also recognize the families of those who served, those who have died, and those perhaps who are still alive. And what I'm going to do, and I talked to Steve about this, and I tried to make a list of all the conflicts we've been in since World War II, and it's impossible. I think there are 19 different conflicts and wars. But I'm going to name some of the main ones. And when you hear the conflict or war that you were involved in, would you please stand in your pew? And then I'd also like to invite any family members whose fathers or uncles or mothers or aunts or other served in the military for you to stand in the pew. Then at the time we will bring the vets up, and those of you who are family members can remain in your pews. So I'd like to name some of those conflicts now, and when you hear that war or conflict, please stand where you are. World War II. It was a war like no other and reached to every corner of the globe. The Korean War. Some call it the Forgotten War, but for 2 years America fought a full-fledged war to keep South Korea safe and free. The Vietnam War. I'm standing for that era. The Gulf War. Desert Storm. The Iraq War. The war in Afghanistan. Any veterans from any other conflicts or periods, please stand now, or family members. Thank you. I'd like now to invite all of the veterans that are here to come up here and join me, just to stand here across the front of the church. With those veterans, please come forward now. Thank you for your service. Thank you for your service. Thank you for your service. We will continue with a couple of prayers and a blessing for our veterans here today. If you are comfortable remaining standing, you may, or you may sit or kneel at this time. For heroic service, we pray. O judge of the nations, we remember before you with grateful hearts the men and women of our country who in the day of decision ventured much for the liberties we now enjoy, and we especially give thanks for these veterans here today. Grant that we may not rest until all the people of this land share the benefits of true freedom and gladly accept its disciplines. This we ask in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
A prayer for those in the armed forces. Almighty God, we commend to your gracious care and keeping all the men and women of our armed forces at home and abroad. Defend them day by day with your grace. Strengthen them in their trials and temptations. Give them grace to face the perils which beset them. And grant them a sense of your abiding presence wherever they may be today. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And now to our veterans, please receive this blessing. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace, now and forevermore. Amen.
Amen.
Could we please give our vets a round of applause? Accept the nomination. Highland Cathedral. She's going to come down here, and then if you would follow her back to your seats. Peace. 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 Please sit for the announcements.
Okay, excuse me, because I got to drive. First, in line with Father Bob Sermon, let me say that I served in the Indiana Army National Guard 38th Division, and Fred served in the Guard Division, the 45th Division, and our motto of the Guard, Army Air Guard and Air Guard, is always ready, always there. So the two boilers have been ordered, thanks to a gift arranged through one of our parishioners. So we're waiting on those. And weather permitting, the next cleanup day, or finish up, or cleanup day, is November 18th, Saturday. We'll start in the morning, after dark. After it's light, so.
Thank you, Steve. Ben?
Just one more day today to sign up to go to Montana Mike's for Opus. If you're interested, it'll be this Tuesday at 5:30 at Montana Mike's.
I hope this will inspire you. I want to tell you I got my flu shot and my COVID shot on Tuesday. Achy arm for several days. Glad to get it done. I hope and encourage all of you to get those shots for the winter. Deb?
We have newsletters and schedules in the parish hall.
Thank you.
So
thank you.
Please pick those up.
Sandy.
Sandy got the newsletters finished, so they're ready to go.
Thank you very much. I have just another thank you, and that is to Kay McLean and Kathy Buchanan, who represented us as our delegates to convention this past Friday and yesterday. So we were well represented at diocesan convention. Thank them. Ascribe to the Lord the honor to his name, bring offerings, and come into his courts. and Eucharistic Prayer B in your booklets, page 9 in your booklets. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. For by water and the Holy Spirit, you have made us a new people in Jesus Christ our Lord, to show forth your glory in all the world. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn, to proclaim the glory of your name. Out of death into life. On the night before he died for us, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, according to his command, O Father,
we remember his death, we proclaim his resurrection, we await his coming in glory.
And we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your cross, and bring us to that heavenly country where, with the Blessed Virgin Mary and all your saints, we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters, through Jesus Christ our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation. By him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. The cup of salvation. The body of Christ, the bread of heaven. Thank you. The post-communion prayer on the bottom of page 13. Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, we thank you for feeding us with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and for assuring us in these holy mysteries that we are living members of the body of your Son and heirs of your eternal kingdom. And now, Father, send us out to do the work you have given us to do, to love and serve you as faithful witnesses of Christ our Lord. To him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit, be in honor and glory, now and forever. Just a couple of notes. One is that there's a reception in the parish hall following the service, and a very beautiful cake in honor of our veterans. And also, I want you to notice the closing hymn is the tune of the Navy hymn, but the words are wonderful, and they include all of those who serve on the land and the sea and the air and beyond. The peace of God that passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. The blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be upon you and remain with you forever. Amen.
Thank you.
I was just reminded by someone that next Sunday, the 19th, is our third Holy Conversations here in the parish, and Jen Phelps will be here next Sunday. Please be here. Thank you. Please join us.